Hello students, today we are going to do one small topic which is related to foreign exchange. We'll call that as international financial management. I would actually call it as a combination of your topic of capital budgeting and international finance, that is forex management. Because in this particular topic, in this particular chapter, we are going to evaluate foreign proposals, foreign investment proposals. In the sense that I will be trying to evaluate whether investing abroad in a foreign country is advisable or not advisable. On what basis do we select this? We select this on the basis of NPV. Yes, you heard it right. Net present value, which is one of the methods of evaluation of your investment proposals or what you call as capital budgeting. So making use of NPV, we will be solving problems, we will be finding out the NPV. If I find that NPV is positive, we will accept the foreign investment proposal, and if the NPV is negative, then we will reject the foreign investment proposal. So this topic is basically a combination of your capital budgeting and foreign exchange management. Okay? There will be only one lecture on this because it's a very small topic, hardly about 6 questions are there, and theory is not much to do. So we can right away start with the topic of international finance. So today's topic will be international financial management, or simply called as international finance, where it is, as I told you, a combination of capital budgeting and foreign exchange, where we are going to have investments which are going to be in foreign countries and evaluation of those investments. Now, the most important thing that we are going to know over here is, the first of all, what are the reasons for which we would like to invest in a foreign country? Why should I go and invest in a foreign country when I can invest in my own country, in my domestic country? So the reason for that is very simple. Maybe in certain countries we get tax benefits. So because of tax benefits which are available in some countries, I can say that it is better to invest in those countries. Second, cheap resources. Labor may be easily available, cheaply available. For example, labor is quite cheap in China. That is why most of the products are manufactured in China, in Taiwan, where the labor is cheap. Or it may be that I want to expand my business. So expansion may be one of the reasons why I am setting up a business unit in another country. Third may be that, I'm always importing raw materials from Germany. So instead of always importing raw materials from Germany and having that foreign exchange rate problem, I will set up my factory only in Germany. I will set up my factory in Germany so that raw materials are locally available. Or suppose I'm exporting my finished products to, let us say, Switzerland. Then instead of exporting my goods from here, manufacturing the goods here and exporting it over there, I will set up a unit in Switzerland where I will manufacture and cater to the local demands in the same country. So easy access to markets, raw material market or finished goods market. Or maybe that I want to diversify into the production of another commodity. That I want to manufacture, I want to change my line of manufacture, I want to diversify. So at present I am manufacturing, pharmaceuticals, medicines, and I want to diversify into the production of, something like cars, automobiles. So in that case, I want to set up a plant in US. So diversification may be one of the reasons. Most important reason, economic and political stability is there in the country. You know, if you remember, just before this Modi government came into power in 2014, we used to have a coalition of governments. Now also it is a coalition only, it is called as an NDA, with the BJP leading and the BJP having the majority. But in those days, before 2014, we used to have a coalition of a lot of parties, number of parties, not one party, but number of parties, where no single party had dominance. Like now we are having BJP as the major party having a majority. So even without the alliance partners, BJP itself can run the government. But in those days, we did not have such a situation where we had all small parties coming together and forming a coalition. So administration was a little bit difficult because each one would threaten the Prime Minister that if you don't do it my way, then I will break from the alliance. I will bring down your government. So political stability was not there for a very long time. Now we find that since 2014, after Modi has won the elections, we find a little bit of political stability, a little bit of political stability coming into India. But otherwise, if there is no political stability, then rules and regulations are not fixed, taxation laws are not fixed. So there is a difficulty in running a business in a country which is not economically strong, which is not politically strong and stable. So this may be some of the reasons why a businessman would like to set up his business outside India. Now we come to evaluation of foreign currency investments. There are two approaches over here. What are the two approaches? One is called as a home currency approach and the other is called as a foreign currency approach. Yes, you heard it right. Home currency approach and foreign currency approach. Under home currency approach, what are the steps involved? There are four steps involved. The first step is convert the foreign currency investment into home currency. That means whatever you are given, that I am going to invest so many dollars in US, immediately convert that amount of investment into home currency. So suppose you are having $1,00,000. So convert that $1,00,000 on the spot rate and find out what is the investment in home currency. Second step is compute the future spot rate, forward rate in other words, based on inflation or based on interest or whatever other methods that we have got. Swap points are given, interest rates are given. So we are actually making use of combination of capital budgeting and what we have learnt in foreign exchange, forex. So forward rate of exchange. So what I mean by future spot rate means it is forward rate of exchange. Okay, so either based on interest rates or based on inflation, I will calculate the future rates. Then convert the foreign currency cash flows into home currency cash flows. FC stands for foreign currency. CF is current cash flows. HC stands for home currency. Okay, so convert the foreign currency cash flows into home currency cash flows. Okay, then using the future rates. After that, discount the home currency cash flows as you normally do in capital budgeting. The cash flows are discounted and we calculate their present values. Once we calculate the present values, then we will calculate the NPV. How to calculate NPV? It is present value of cash inflow minus present value of cash outflow. Okay? Now, foreign currency approach, also there are four steps. What is to be done? I solve the entire problem in foreign currency. And then the final figure, whatever is there, that is the NPV, is converted into home currency. Okay? In home currency approach, we first step is to convert into home currency. In foreign currency, I'll solve entire problem in foreign currency only. And the last figure, that is the NPV, will be converted at spot rate into home currency. So the first step will be compute the foreign currency investment in foreign currency. Second, calculate the adjusted discount rate applicable for foreign currency cash flows. And here we have to use something called as a project premium model or the inflation model. We'll come to that as to how to, what is the meaning of that, and it is also called as a risk premium model. So we'll make use of that and calculate the adjusted discount rate. So why we have to calculate the adjusted discount rate? Because there are some reasons for this. Now the risk of the particular project, remains the same in both the countries. But this should be adjusted, because now we are going to a foreign country. See, risk of a project means what? That whether the project will be feasible or not feasible, whether the project will be giving me enough cash flows or not. That has got nothing to do with the political environment. But continuity of that and taxation of that, so also will be taken into consideration. That means I will have to consider the taxation rate, I will have to consider the rate at which it is going to be discounted, the government policies, the economic environment. So all these factors are to be considered when I think about a discounting rate. Correct? When I think about a discounting rate. So what will happen is that those particular things may affect my risk of the project. So I calculate the adjusted risk premium model. Okay? Then after that, the third step is discount all the cash flows. Discount all the cash flows. That is the foreign cash flows, foreign currency cash flows, to calculate the NPV. And after calculating NPV, convert that NPV into home currency by using the spot rate. So these are the two approaches which are there. That means conversion into spot, into home currency is the last step here. So this is the first step here, this is the last step here. So entire problem is to be solved. So only point number two is important here. And that is the difference. Okay, so now let us see what is that particular point. Risk premium model, as we call it as, the required rate of return or the cost of capital for a particular project in any country depends upon two factors, risk-free rate of return and the risk premium. The risk premium for a project remains the same in different countries. That risk premium means what? How much risk is there for that particular project? Okay. Therefore, the risk-free rate appropriate for the foreign country should be adjusted for the risk premium of the project to get the appropriate discount rate. So the following steps are to be undertaken. First, calculate the project risk premium at home currency. What is the formula for that? 1 plus home currency discounting rate. All this is given in your book. It is given in the book, so no need to copy. 1 plus home currency discounting rate is equal to 1 plus home currency risk-free rate. Understand interpretation, understand the words. 1 plus home currency discounting rate, that is 1 plus discounting rate, local discounting rate, is equal to 1 plus home currency risk-free rate multiplied by 1 plus project risk premium. Now this is not given to us in the question. This will not be given. So this is what we have to calculate. Okay? So this will be given. Discounting rate, home currency discounting rate is given, home currency risk-free rate is given. So after substituting this, I will find out the project risk premium. Then I will find out the foreign currency discounting rate. So over here, what is missing? Here, this is missing. Foreign currency discounting rate. So they will give you the foreign currency risk-free rate of interest, and this we will get from here. Okay? So three things are given to you. Home currency discounting rate, home currency risk-free rate, and foreign currency risk-free rate. So first you will calculate the project risk premium, which is going to be the same in foreign currency and home currency. So you will calculate that, then substitute in the second formula here, and then solve and get the foreign discounting rate. After you get the foreign currency discounting rate, you will discount all the cash flows, calculate the present values, calculate the NPV also in foreign currency, and then we move ahead, calculate the NPV. After NPV is calculated, convert into home currency at spot rate, and then we evaluate. So these are the two things which are there, which we have to know. Now, coming back to, since I have not taught you investment appraisal, I have not taught you capital budgeting, I will just like to revise with you as to how I will be solving the problems of capital budgeting NPV method. Net present value method. It may be the same as what you have done, may have a small difference in the calculation, the method of writing, etc. So I will just discuss with you as to what is going to be my method of solving the problem. Okay, so let us see how to calculate NPV. As for my method, what are the points that we are going to follow? Simple things, don't have to worry about anything. NPV, first of all, NPV formula is equal to present value of cash inflow minus present value of cash outflow. Correct? Formula is same. Achha. Now, present value of cash outflow is also called as initial cash flow. It is also called as initial cash flow. Now, what all things will come in the initial cash flow? Initial cash flow, there will be two things. There will be one main principle that we have to follow. What is the principle that we have to follow? The main principle that is to be followed here is that we have to consider only capital items. Now, students of accounts, you know what is the meaning of capital items. Capital and revenue. Capital. Capital items. Capital income. Capital expenditure. Capital profit. Capital loss. And all one-time expenses. One-time expenses which are incurred at the commencement of the project. One-time expenses at the commencement of the project. For example, you are incurring training of workers at the beginning of the project, before the project starts. You are training the workers how to operate the machine. So that is a one-time expenditure. So one-time expenditure at the commencement of the project will be a part of your initial cash flow. Present value of cash inflow is divided into two parts. One is called as annual cash flow and one is called as terminal cash flow. Annual cash flow and terminal cash flow. Annual cash flow is the yearly cash flows that you are going to have. Yearly cash flow. So it will be purely revenue in nature. That means all the revenue expenses, revenue income, revenue profit, revenue loss. Sales, income from sales, revenue from sales. Your normal expenses of production, that means whatever you write in the profit and loss account, whatever items you write in the profit and loss account will come over here as yearly revenue expenses. So here we are having capital expenses, capital items, here we are having revenue items. Terminal cash flows, there are two possibilities that may come. What are the two possibilities? The two possibilities are, one is salvage value of assets used in the business, salvage value of assets used in the project. And second, if you have invested working capital at the beginning, then that working capital will be released at the end of the project. So salvage value of assets used in the project and working capital that is normally introduced at the beginning. If there is no working capital introduced at the beginning, then there is nothing that will come at the end also. Okay? So this is how we calculate. So once I get this, I put it into the formula. I calculate the NPV. If NPV is positive, I accept. If NPV is negative, I reject. So these are the principles that we are going to follow when we are solving the problems on International Financial Investment Management. Okay, so this is what we are going to do in this particular chapter. There are about 6 questions over here. We'll just run through the questions and see how to solve the questions. Okay, let us now start with question number 1. So turn to your material, page 211. Question number 1. LB Incorporation is considering a new plant in the Netherlands. The plant will cost 26 million guilders. That is the currency of Netherlands. Guilders. Dutch guilders. DG. Incremental cash flows are expected to be 3 million guilders per year for the first 3 years. 3 million means 30 lakhs. Okay. 4 million guilders for the next 3. 5 million guilders in year 7 through 9. And 6 million guilders in years 10 through 19. After which the project will terminate with no residual value. No residual value. So terminal cash flows are not there. The present exchange rate is 1.90 guilders per dollar. So this is your spot rate. Spot rate. The required rate of return on the repatriated dollar is 16%. Cost of capital, 16%. Cost of capital, 16% for dollars. My home currency, see, if you read the question, LB Incorporation is considering a new plant in Netherlands. So, guilders is the foreign currency. Home currency is the dollar. So, home currency is dollar, foreign currency is guilder. So, they are saying that spot rate of conversion is 1.90 guilders per dollar. Required rate of return on repatriated dollar is 16%. This is home currency discounting rate. Home currency discounting rate. If the exchange rate stays at 1.90 for all the 19 years, what is the project net present value, NPV? Case B. If the guilder appreciates to 1.84 for years 1 to 3, 1.78 for years 4 to 6, 1.72 for years 7 to 9, this is 7 to 9, 1.72 for years 7 to 9, 1.65 for years 10 to 19, then what happens to the present value? That means what is the new NPV that we are going to have? Okay, question you have understood. Nothing is mentioned in the question. I will solve by home currency approach. First, convert everything into home currency. Calculate the NPV as per home currency. And what is my home currency here? Dollar. Okay, so let us see how to solve the question now. Okay. Write case 1. If exchange rate remains stable at 1.90, present value of cash outflows, or what we call in capital budgeting as initial cash flows, all capital items. So what will come? Cost of the project, 26 million guilders, that is 2 crore 60 lakh guilders. 26 million is 2 crore 60. 26 million guilders is equal to 2 crore 60 lakhs. Spot rate, convert it. You will get 1 crore 36 lakhs, 84,000. 210. Okay, so that is the spot rate is going to remain the same, 1.90. So 2 crore 60 lakhs divided by 1.90, you will get in dollars 1 crore 36 lakhs 84,210. Now we calculate present value of cash inflows. For that I will prepare year column, cash flows column in guilders, divided by the exchange rate, you will get the current currency cash flows in dollar, that is home currency, discounting rate, home currency discounting rate 16%, and the present values. So year column, cash flows in guilders, that is I have written G. This is cash flow in guilders, foreign currency. This is cash flow in dollar. So you are having exchange rate over here. So this will convert the guilders into dollars. After converting into dollars, I will discount it at home currency discounting rate, 16%, and then calculate the present values. Achha, how to write the years now? 19 years are there, but it is 3 million for the first 3 years, 4 million for the next 3 years. So I will group the years now. So I will take it as 1 to 3, 4 to 6, 7 to 9, and 10 to 90. Okay? For the first 3 years, first, second and third year, it is 30 lakhs or 3 million each year. For the next 3 years, that is years 4 to 6, it is 4 million, that is 40 lakhs. For years 7 to 9, it is 5 million, that is 50 lakhs. And 10 to 19, it is 6 million, that is 60 lakhs. Okay, point is clear. Achha, exchange rate is going to remain stable, that means it is going to remain same, 1.90. So now each of the figure, you will divide by 1.90. Okay, so first one I divide, 30 lakhs divided by 1.90. I'll get 15,78,947. 40 lakhs divided by 1.90 will come to 21,05,263. 50 lakhs divided by 1.90, I'll get 26,31,579. And 60 lakhs divided by 1.90, I'll get 31,57,895. I'm having some wonderful birds chirping outside my window. The weather in Bangalore has become very cool because of the rains just yesterday and day before yesterday. So you may find some beautiful birds humming outside my window. Beautiful climate. Okay, now discounting factor. How do you calculate? 1 divided by 1.16. 1 divided by 1.16. But it is annuity for 3 years. For 3 years. So 1 divided by 1.16, you press equal to function 3 times on the calculator. And then there is one GT function on the calculator. There is a GT function on the calculator. Okay? So press the GT function. You'll get 2.2459. It is annuity for first 3 years. So 1 divided by 1.16, equal to function 3 times, and then press the GT function. Those who are not having GT function, alternative, I'm telling you alternative, 1 divided by 1.16, 1 divided by 1.16, and then you press equal to M plus, equal to M plus, equal to M plus, 3 times, and then you press MRMC, you will get the same answer, 2.2459. Okay, so either you go by the GT function or you go by the equal to M plus function. Annuity for first 3 years, then you calculate annuity for first 6 years, 1 divided by 1.16, equal to function 6 times, and then the GT function, you'll get something like 3.6847. That is the annuity for 6 years. Minus from that, 2.2459. 2.2459. So you'll get the annuity of the last 3 years. That is 1.4388. 1.4388. Then you calculate annuity for 9 years and minus both these annuities, the first annuity and the second annuity. Calculate annuity for 9 years and minus the 6 years annuity. You will get 0.9218. 0.9218. And 10 to 19, you calculate annuity for 19 years minus all these 3 rates. You will get the last 10 years. Annuity for 19 years minus the 3 annuities that we have just calculated. So that will come to 1.2710. So those who are not used to calculations, finding it difficult, you can contact me. We'll have a one-to-one class on solving your problem. But I think most of you know how to calculate annuities here. You have done this in inter-CA also. and you have it in capital budgeting at final level also. Okay, so this is 6 years annuity minus 3 years first three annuity. Then this is 9 years annuity minus the first two annuity. Then this is the 19 years annuity minus the first 3 years. So go on subtracting each of them. Okay. Now what you do is present value. How do you calculate present value? 15,78,947 multiplied by 2.2459. 15,78,947 multiplied by 2.2459. You have done this in capital budgeting here. 21,05,263 multiplied by 1.4388. Likewise, you will get the third one, fourth one. Now take the total of this. Total of all these present values. Total of all the present values. That comes to 1,30,14,684. 1,30,14,684. Now use the formula, NPV formula. Present value of cash inflow minus present value of cash outflow. This is your cash inflow. Present value of cash inflow. From this minus 1,36,00,000. So you will get a negative figure. Minus $6,69,527. As per the rule of NPV, if NPV is negative, we reject. So we reject the proposal. We will not set up a new plant in Netherlands. So write conclusion. Since NPV is negative, the company should not set up a new plant. The company should not set up a new plant in Netherlands. That is our first method, first case, where rates of exchange are supposed to remain constant. But if the rates of exchange are not going to remain constant, then what? So the cash flows will change. The cash flows will change. Discounting factor will remain the same. Okay? So let us solve the case 2. Exchange rate fluctuates. Prepare same table, year column, cash flows in guilders. Exchange rate is going to be different for different years now. Write down the exchange rates given to you. Divide now. Each of the cash flows in guilders, you divide by the exchange rate. You will get the cash flows in dollar. So 30 lakhs divided by 1.84. 40 lakhs divided by 1.78. 50 lakhs divided by 1.72. And 60 lakhs divided by 1.65. Discounting factors you copy from the previous table. Same figures. Discounting factors, same figures. Multiply now. Cash flows in dollars multiplied by the discounting factor. $36,61,794, $32,33,258, $26,79,651, and $46,21,819. Now take the total of all this. Last column total, present values. How much you get? 1,41,96,522. All have dropped down from heaven. 1,41,96,522. Okay, now we'll calculate NPV. From 1,41,96,000, I'll subtract that outflow of cash, 1,36,84,211. So now we get a positive NPV, $5,12,311. So what is the conclusion? Rule of NPV says if NPV is positive, we'll accept. If NPV is positive, we will accept. So since NPV is positive, company may set up new plant in Netherlands if the exchange rate is likely to fluctuate. Done. So this is how we are going to calculate. This is the home currency approach. I will do one more problem with home currency approach. And then we'll see the foreign currency approach also. So in home currency approach, what we do, everything is to be converted into home currency first. Initial investment at the spot rate, annual cash flows, inflows of cash at the respective spot rates, that is the exchange rates for the particular years, multiply by the discounting factor of home currency, calculate present values, calculate NPV. So the NPV calculated is in dollars, in home currency. Okay, let us see question 2 now. Question 2, market is important. OJ Limited is a supplier of leather goods to retailers in the UK and other Western European countries. The company is considering entering into a joint venture with a manufacturer in South America. The two companies will each own 50% of the limited liability company, which will be called as JV South America, SA, and will share the profits equally. £450,000 of the initial capital is being provided by OJ Limited, and the equivalent in South American dollars is being provided by the foreign partner. Managers of the joint venture expect the following net operating cash flows, which are in nominal terms. Year 1, slightly gone up. Okay, now you can see. Year 1, year 2, year 3. Year 1, 4,250 South American dollars, all the figures are in thousands, which means it is 42,50,000. Then second one is 65 lakhs. Third one is 83,50,000. Forward rates of exchange to the pound sterling means South African dollar to the pound. What is this now? Sorry, South American dollar to the pound. That is 10, 15 and 21. For tax reasons, joint venture SV, the company to be formed specifically for the joint venture, will be registered in South America. Ignore taxation in your calculations. Assume you are the financial advisor. It is financial advisor. Assume you are the financial advisor retained by OJ Limited to advise on the proposed joint venture. Only assume you are not. Calculate the NPV of the project under the two assumptions explained below. Use a discounting rate of 18% for both the assumptions. Assumption 1. Pay attention. Assumption 1. The South American country has exchange controls which prohibits the payment of dividend above 50% of the annual cash flows for the first 3 years. The accumulated balance can be repatriated at the end of third year. What it is saying? More than 50% of your annual cash flows cannot be repatriated, cannot be sent back to your home country. So, business is in South America. You cannot send back to England, London, your entire share of profits. So, there is one company in London and there is one company in South America. Your business is in South America, but the South American rule says, taxation rule says, that your share, which is 50%, your share is 50%. Your share is 50%. Suppose you have got a profit of 100 rupees. What is your share? Your share is 50 rupees. But they are saying that this 50 rupees cannot be taken entirely back to your country. 50% only can be allowed. That is, you can take back. You can take back, not 50, but only 25. 25 you will retain here. And the South American business will get 50. So out of your 50, you can take only half of your profits. I'll tell you what is the implication of that. Assumption number 2, government of South American country is considering removing the exchange controls and the restriction on the repatriation of profits. If this happens, all the cash flows will be distributed as dividend to the partner companies. Let us come to this figure now. 42,50,000. 42,50,000 is your profit. Entire profit. Your share is how much? Half of that. So 42,50,000 ka half. Your share is 21,25,000. But you cannot take your entire share back to country. Out of that you can take only 50% of the amount. That means the amount that you can take is 10,62,500. Half of this also. So out of your share, this is your share. This is total profit. This is my share. Out of my share of 21,25,000, I can take back only half of the profits. So I can take back only 10,62,500. That is why problem becomes important. Interpretation has to be understood. So this 65 lakhs is the total profit. So 32,50,000 is your share of profit. How much you can take back? Half of this, 16,25,000. Like this I will be calculating. So the problem becomes important. Okay. So calculations, interpretations, you have to know. This is the only thing that is there in the, this is the only catch in the problem. Otherwise problem is very simple. Otherwise problem is very, very simple. Have you understood? Shall we see the solution of this? So, right, assumption 1, that means restrictions are there. Present value of cash outflows, 4,50,000 pounds. Present value of cash outflows, 4,50,000 pounds. Again, I am going by home currency approach only. I am not taking the second approach. I have not taken the second approach now. Present value of cash inflows. I will prepare a table. Your column, dividend received in South American dollars. Exchange rate, dividend in pounds. Discounting factor at 18%. Present value. Years. I have shown you calculation. So now we go as per the calculations. So what are the calculations now? First year figure was 42,50,000. 25% of that. Your share is 42,50,000 or half. So your share is 21,25,000. 21,25,000, half of that is 10,62,500. Second year, it is 65 lakhs. Out of 65 lakhs, your share is 32,50,000. Out of that 32,50,000, half can be carried forward. So 16,25,000 you can take back home. Third year is your last year of business. So what you have not carried forward in the first year, plus what you have not carried forward in the second year, plus the full amount of third year. Achha, 83,50,000 is your total profit. Your share is how much? 41,75,000. So 41,75,000 plus 10,62,500 plus 16,25,000, what you have not carried forward earlier. This is the balance that is left behind. You took only 10,62,500. Remaining 10,62,500 was in South America only. In second year, you took only 16,25,000. Remaining 16,25,000 was still in South America. So last year ka your share 83,50,000 plus into 50% plus 10,62,500 of the first year that you have not taken. And 16,25,000 of the second year that you have not taken will be now added, and total amount comes to 68,62,500. So please note this calculation somewhere. Okay, now the exchange rate. Three rates are given to you, 10, 15 and 21. Exchange rate, 10, 15 and 21. Convert now. 10,62,500 into 10, exchange rate, into 10. It's 1,06,250. You should know when to multiply and when to divide. Very careful. 16,25,000 into 15. Sorry, divide. You have to divide, not multiply. 10,62,500 divided by 10. 16,25,000 divided by 15, sorry. You get 1,08,333. 68,62,500 divided by 21. 68,62,500 divided by 21, 326,786. Discounting factor at 18%, 1 divided by 1.18. First figure up to 4 decimals. I will take all figures, factors always to be taken up to 4 decimals. 0.8475 plus equal to again 7182. Last one 6086. Multiply the dividend in pounds by the discounting factors. 90,047, 77,805, 1,98,882. Now take the total of present values. Three lakh sixty-six thousand seven thirty-four. NPV formula. 3,66,734 minus 4,50,000. So you get a negative NPV of 83,266 pounds. What is the rule of NPV? If NPV is negative, reject. So joint venture should not be undertaken. Joint venture should not be undertaken. This is the assumption one, where we are taking into consideration only 50% of the total amount. That we are our share, 50% of our share. That is 25% of total amount. Now assumption two. Present value of cash outflows 4,50,000 pounds. Present value of cash inflows. Same figures. Dividend will be now 100% of my share. My share is half the amount of profits. So 21,25,000, 32,50,000, and 41,75,000. Divided by the exchange rate, you'll get the dividend in pounds. Discounting factors. Multiply, you will get the present values. Done. These are the values that you will get. Take the total of all the present values. Calculate the NPV. Calculate the NPV. Positive. So as per the rule of NPV, if it is positive, then we will accept. Joint venture should be undertaken. Joint venture should be undertaken. So read the question carefully, understand the solution, do it twice. I've told you this is an important problem, do it twice. After the lecture is over, sit with the question, understand the question first, see where I've asked you to underline, okay? And then see the solution, see both the solutions, both the assumptions, see if you have understood. Okay? Let us come to question 4 now. Question 4. No, first question 4, then we'll come to question 3. Company, a UK company, UK based company, is considering undertaking a new project in Australia. The project would require immediate capital expenditure of 10 million Australian dollars plus 5 million Australian dollars of working capital, which would be recovered at the end of the project. So terminal cash flow will come. Okay. The net cash flows expected to be generated from the project are 13 million Australian dollars before tax, straight line depreciation, 13 million dollars before tax on cash flows. Cash flows before tax means EBDT, earnings before depreciation and tax. Straight line depreciation over the life of the project are allowable expenses against company, which is charged at the rate of 50% payable, okay, without delay. So rate of tax is 50%. Project will have zero scrap value. So scrap value at the last is not there. Terminal cash flows, I don't have the scrap value, I have the working capital released. Butler company will not have to pay any UK tax on the project due to a double taxation avoidance agreement. They have done direct tax. The Australian to pound spot rate is 2. Spot rate is 2.0. And UK pound is expected to appreciate. Pound is supposed to appreciate in value by 10% each year, per year. Okay. A similar risk UK based project would be expected to generate a minimum return of 20%. This is your discounting factor. Fine. Now let us start this problem as if it is a capital budgeting problem. First, let's start with initial cash flows. Initial cash flows, initial capital expenditure, 10 million Australian dollars, that is 1 crore. Spot rate is 2. So 1 crore divided by 2, 50 lakh pounds. 50 lakh pounds. Investment in working capital, 50 lakhs divided by 2, 25 lakh pounds. Total present value of cash outflow, 75 lakhs. Method is still home currency approach. Then we have annual cash flows. Earnings before, cash flow before tax is given. So EBDT is given in Australian dollars. I'll have to convert this, but first I'll have to calculate what is the final figure, final cash flow. 13 million, that is 1 crore 30 lakhs. EBDT, that means I have to minus depreciation, I have to minus tax, and then add back depreciation to calculate the annual cash flows. Depreciation 1 crore divided by how many years? 4 years. Project is going to last for 4 years. So 1 crore divided by 4, 25 lakhs. NPBT, net profit before tax. Net profit before tax. 1 crore 5 lakhs. Less tax of 50%. 52 lakh 50. Add back the depreciation. 25 lakhs because we want to calculate cash flow. 77,50,000 is a cash flow. 77,50,000 is a cash flow. Now, the cash flow has to be converted first into pounds. This is in Australian dollars. And then all these cash flows have to be discounted at 20% to get the present values. So now I prepare the table. Year column, cash flows in Australian dollars, exchange rate, cash flows in pounds, discounting factor at 20%. Cash flows in Australian pounds, you have calculated it is going to be 77,50,000 every year. Every year. And the rate of exchange is going to increase by 10% every year. So as of now, spot rate is 2. So at the end of first year, it will be 2 plus 10%, 2.2. 2.2 plus 10%, that is 2.42. 2.42 plus 10%, that is 2.662. 2.662 plus 10%, 2.9282. Now divide the Australian dollars by the exchange rate. Divide by the exchange rate. You will get the cash flows in pounds. Calculate discounting factor. How to calculate discounting factor? 1 divided by 1.2. Up to 4 decimals, 0.8333, 0.6944, 0.5787, 0.4823. Multiply the pound cash flows by the discounting factors. Multiply the cash flows in pound by the discounting factor. Take the total of all the present values. You get 81,20,576. This is your present value of annual cash flows. Now terminal cash flows will be there. So write terminal cash flows. What is going to come? Working capital is going to come back again. Salvage value is nil. So working capital 50 lakhs. And this is the last year, now last year it is coming in, last year cut discounting rate, exchange rate, sorry, is 2.9282 and discounting rate 0.4823. So first I will convert this into pound sterling and then I multiply by the discounting factor for the last year. 50 lakhs Australian dollars is going to come back again. Is going to return at the last year. So that will be first converted by dividing by exchange rate in the last year. And then whatever I get, I multiply that by the discounting factor of last year. So now present value of cash inflow will be this figure 81,20,576 plus 8,23,543. Both are inflows of cash. Both are inflows of cash. So total cash inflow is 89,44,119. NPV is calculated. Positive NPV. So final conclusion, since the NPV is positive, company can proceed with the project. Clear? Now let us come to question 3. You have been engaged to evaluate an investment project overseas in a country called East Africa, which is a politically stable country. The project involves an initial cost of East African dollar 2.5 crores and it is expected to earn post-tax cash flows as follows. You are given the figures 75 lakhs in the first year, 95 lakhs in the second year, 125 lakhs in the third year, and 135 lakhs in the fourth year. Further, the following information is available. Current spot rate is East African dollar 2 per 1 rupee. Risk-free rate of interest in East Africa is 7%, India 9%. Required return from the project is 16%. You may make suitable, generally acceptable assumptions in order to evaluate the project. Now I can solve this project by the first method, but I will also solve it, but I will solve it by the second method. Because why? Because they have given me the risk-free rate. When will this come? This will come only in the second method. It is not that I can't solve by the first method. I can solve, but I want to solve by the second method. Because first method too, you know how to solve now. I want to solve by the second method. Okay, so now what we will do is home currency approach. I want you to solve at home. Home currency approach. So at home you will do this as homework, and I will teach you how to do the foreign currency approach. Fair enough. So we will be doing foreign currency approach calculation and not the home currency approach calculation. So let us see. Home currency I am not doing. I am doing foreign currency approach. Home currency approach you will be doing at home for homework. And then you will tell me the answer. You will message me on my number. He said this is the answer that we have got. Is it correct or not? Foreign currency approach. In foreign currency approach I have told you that three figures are given to us. Home currency discounting rate, home currency risk-free rate, and foreign currency risk-free rate. Okay, now first job is to calculate project risk premium. What is the formula? 1 plus home currency discounting rate is equal to, we'll do it slowly, no need of hurrying. 1 plus home currency discounting rate is equal to 1 plus home currency risk-free rate into 1 plus project risk premium. What is given to me? Home currency discounting rate is given. How much? 16%. Check. 16%. Then I am given home currency risk-free rate. How much? 9%. 9%. Correct? Huh? So 1.16 is equal to 1.09. into 1 plus risk premium, 16%, so 0.16, 1 plus 0.16, 1.16, home currency risk free rate 9%, that is 0.09, so 1 plus 0.09 is 1.09, so 1 plus risk premium is equal to 1.16 divided by 1.09, that is approximately equal to 1.06422. Minus 1 from that, so risk premium is equal to 0.06422. So in percentage terms, if you want, it will be 6.422%. Now once I get this project risk premium, I will put it in the second formula to calculate the foreign discount rate. Foreign discount rate I don't have now. Now in this, what is given? In this, I am given foreign currency risk-free rate of interest. How much? 7%. Foreign currency risk-free rate of interest, 7%. How much is project risk premium I have got? So foreign discounting rate is 13.87%. 13.87%. So now I am doing entirely in foreign currency only. Everything I am going to keep in foreign currency. Last figure of NPV, whatever I get, I will convert at spot rate. Last figure of NPV. Okay? Present value of cash outflows, initial investment, East African, 2 crore 50 lakhs, that is 25 million. $2 crore 50 lakh. I'm keeping it in foreign currency only. I'm not converting into home currency. Entire problem is to be solved in foreign currency. Present value of cash inflows. Present, prepare the table. Year column, cash flows in East African dollars. Discounting factor at 13.87 and present value. Cash flows are given to you. How to calculate discounting factor? 1 divided by 1.1387. 1 divided by 1.1387. First figure is 0.8782 and 0.7712, 0.6773, 0.5948. Multiply. 65,86,500, 73,26,400, 1 crore 25 into 0.6773 is 84,66,250. Last one, 1 crore 35 lakhs into 0.5948, that is 80,29,800. Now take the total of all these figures. That will come to 3 crore 4 lakhs 8,950. Now to calculate NPV. In foreign currency only, NPV in foreign currency. 3 crore 4 lakh 8950 minus 2 crore 50 lakhs. So we get NPV as 54 lakh 8950. Now this is in foreign currency. I want to convert it into home currency. That is in rupees. So convert at spot rate. What is the spot rate? 2 East African dollars per rupee. So converted at spot rate, divide. You'll get the NPV as 27,04,475 rupees. Last figure you have converted at spot rate. Entire problem was solved in foreign currency. Positive. So since NPV is positive, the project is viable. Since NPV is positive, the project is viable. Okay. Let us take question 5 now. C Sun Limited is planning to import an equipment from Japan at a cost of 3,400 lakh yen. The company may avail loans at 18% per annum with quarterly rest. That means it is compounded on a quarterly basis. It is calculated on a quarterly basis with which it can import the equipment. The company has also an offer from Osaka branch of an India-based bank extending credit of 180 days at 2% per annum. Present exchange rate, that means spot rate, is 340 yen per 100 rupees. 340 yen per 100 rupees. Indirect quote. 180 days forward rate, 100 rupees at 345 yen. That means 345 yen per 100 rupees. Forward rate. Commission charges for letter of credit at 2% per 12 months. Advise the company whether offer from the foreign branch should be accepted. That means I will have to solve with two options. Loan taken from in India only, in Indian currency, where the loan will be calculated at 18% interest. Second option, where Osaka branch of the Indian company, of the Indian bank, is offering 2% per annum for 180 days. One is to be calculated in months, the other is to be calculated in days. Now, what we will do is, we will write a small assumption here. Write here in your book, assume year to be of 360 operating days. Okay, assume year to be of 360 operating days. Clear? So now option one for me is loan taken in India, where the rate of interest is calculated at 18% for every 3 months. Now what I have to see is, where is the outflow of cash less? Whichever option gives me less amount of cash outflow, I will be selecting that particular option. Okay? So let us see how to solve now. Option 1. Loan taken for a purchase of machine. Loan taken for a purchase of machine at 18% per annum. So this is my home loan at home. What is the cost of the machine? 3,400 lakh yen, but 340 yen is equal to 100 rupees. So 3,400 lakh is equal to 1,000 lakhs. So cost of machine at spot rate, what is given to us? 340 yen per rupee, per 100 rupees. So for 3,400 yen, it will be 1,000 rupees, 1,000 lakhs. Now calculate 18% interest on this, 18% on 1,000 for 3 months. 18% on 1,000 lakhs for 3 months. That is 45 lakhs. So total amount is 1,045 lakhs. First 3 months. Now next 3 months, again, we will calculate 18% interest on 1,045. 18% interest for, you can write here, next 3 months. For next 3 months. 18% now on 1045. Compounded after every 3 months. Interest on interest. Compounded means interest on interest. So that comes to 47.03 lakhs. So total outflow of cash under option 1 is 1092.03 lakhs. Now here there is no requirement of commission to be paid for LC. LC is to be paid only if you are having foreign currency problems. Now here you are taking loan in Indian currency only, na? So why do you require an LC? Follow what I am saying. So commission is not required. Commission will be payable only when LC is to be opened. LC is opened when you take a loan in foreign currency, when you take a loan in yen. So only in second option that particular commission will come. Okay. So here the amount is 1092. Let us take option 2 now. Loan taken for purchase of machinery, 3400 lakh yen. Plus 2% interest for 6 months straight away. But how do we calculate 6 months now? 180 days. It is 2% for 180 days. And total number of operating days to be assumed as 360. So 2% of, if that assumption was not given, you can take 365. 2% of 3400 for 180 days. So that comes to 34 lakhs. So total amount of cash outflow excluding commission is 3434 lakhs. Convert this at the forward rate. Convert this at the forward rate. 345 yen per 100 rupees. That is 3.45 yen. 3.45 yen per rupee. So divide 3434 by 3.45. So the amount comes to 995.36 lakhs. Now add the commission plus commission charges. 2% of LC. LC will be equivalent amount of 3400 lakh yen, that is 1000 lakhs. So 2% of 1000 lakhs for 6 months. 2% for 1000 lakhs. Because we are paying the commission in India for opening letter of credit in India. So amount is payable in rupees. 2% of 1000 into 6 by 12. So that comes to 10 lakhs. So total outflow of cash, 1005.36 lakhs. First method, it was how much? 1092 point something, na? 1092.03. As per the first method, option 1. So where is the outflow of cash less? Where are we paying less? We are paying less in option 2. That means if I take a loan in foreign currency and pay commission for opening LC, then it is cheaper for me. It is cheaper for me. Outflow of cash is less. So offer of the Osaka branch should be accepted. So right now, since outflow of cash is comparatively lower, since outflow of cash is comparatively lower in option 2, the offer of the Osaka branch of Indian Bank, should be accepted. Okay. Last question. Question number 6. This is a theoretical concept actually. Just to understand whether you have, just to see whether you have understood forex or not. Foreign exchange, if you have followed, then you will be able to write the answer for this. Simple question, but a conceptual question. Question number 6. A US company owes an amount of $50 lakh to one of its affiliates, sister concern. payable in 3 months' time in some other country. Affiliate payable in 3 months' time in some other country. The payment can be led or lagged for 90 days. That means it can be preponed or postponed for 90 days. So the term used for prepone and postpone in Forex is lead or lag. Lead means bring it forward. Prepone. Lag means postpone. Lending and borrowing rates in the two countries are given. In US it is 4.3 and 3.4%. In the other country it is 3.9 and 3.6%. Should the US firm lead or lag the payment? Find out the effect on the net income of the group. Assume that, this is important. US company at present is borrowing funds while the affiliate is having excess funds. That means US company does not have money to pay. So if it all has to lead the payment, prepone the payment, it has to borrow. Okay. And if it is going to borrow, it will borrow at what rate? 3.4%. It will borrow at 3.4%. And that is if it is preponing. And it makes the payment to the affiliate in the other country. The other country affiliate receives the amount in advance by 90 days. So it will lend this amount. It will invest the amount at 3.9%. Follow what I'm saying. If the US company is going to prepone the payment by 90 days, company is running on borrowed funds. US company is running on borrowed funds. Does not have cash with it. So it is going to prepone the payment. So it will have to borrow 50 lakhs at 3.4% and give it to its affiliate. Now affiliate is surprised. It says, "Arey, I have got the payment in advance by 90 days. Let me invest this and get interest for 90 days. So it lends, it invests for 90 days at 3.9%. So is there a benefit? Yes, to the group there is a benefit. To the group, US company plus the affiliate, together it is one single company. It is like holding company and subsidiary company. So for the entire group as one whole, it is earning interest at 3.9% is income, and it is paying interest expenditure of 3.4%. So it is getting a benefit of 0.5%. So don't you think that benefit of 0.5% should be encashed? Yes. Okay. So how to write this now? In the given case, the US firm has to borrow. The US firm has to borrow $50 lakh. $50 lakh to lead the payment by 3 months. 90 days, 3 months. To lead the payment by 3 months. The affiliate firm, comma, if receives this payment, can invest it for 3 months. So from the point of view of the group, the cost of borrowing would be 3.4%. And the income would be at 3.9%. Thus, incremental income of the group incremental income of the group would be at 0.5%. At 0.5%, around $50 lakh. On $50 lakh. Therefore, net income for the group would be $50 lakh into 0.5% for 3 months. That is $6,250. Okay. So with this, we come to an end to this topic of international financial management. Forex is over. But the next topic that we are going to start is derivatives. And derivatives, I may include a little bit of foreign exchange also. Okay. So my next lecture will be on derivatives. Again, a very important topic. Major part of your paper will be on this. And I'm sure that you will enjoy derivatives as you have enjoyed Forex. As far as Forex is concerned, I've got a lot of messages from CMS Hyderabad students as well as other students who are doing CMA, who are doing CA final. And they have just loved the lecture because it has been simplified so much that they said that, sir, in the beginning we were having fear of Forex topic. But now we are able to understand what we are doing. Even if we are not able to solve the problem correctly, we are able to understand what we are doing. So that is an achievement by itself. That from zero you have gone to some number, that you have got something to do, that you are understanding some calculations, you are understanding the working. So that is an achievement, because Forex is something absolutely new for you. In the same way as derivatives is going to be absolutely new for you. So these are the things which I have simplified as much as possible. I do not know whether it has been beneficial for you. But I am sure, because the feedback that I am getting, and now after this lecture you are also going to give me the feedback as to how the lecture on Forex in totality was. And whether you have been able to understand those. There were some students who had already given an attempt of CMA final, CA final, SFM paper. They had already given one attempt. They said that, sir, we gave that attempt without doing these topics in detail. And we did not have that confidence at all. But now we have understood why we are doing a particular step, why we are doing a particular calculation. And now we have understood Forex better. So like that, I am absolutely sure that derivatives also will go on very smoothly if you are doing it systematically. So, till the next lecture, stay at home, stay safe. I will be reaching out to you through video lectures. Nothing to worry. God bless you. Thank you.